The next day, May 29th, Cochon summoned his serfs, and 42 responded. It is charitable to believe that the other 20 were ashamed to come. The 42 pronounced her a relapsed heretic, and condemned her to be delivered over to the secular arm. Cochon thanked them. Then he sent orders that Joan of Arc be conveyed the next morning to the place known as the Old Market, and that she be then delivered to the civil judge, and by the civil judge to the executioner. That meant she would be burnt. All the afternoon and evening of Tuesday the 29th, the news was flying, and the people of the countryside flocking to Rouen to see the tragedy, all, at least, who could prove their English sympathies and count upon admission. The press grew thicker and thicker in the streets, the excitement grew higher and higher, and now a thing was noticeable again which had been noticeable more than once before, that there was pity for Joan in the hearts of many of these people. Whenever she had been in great danger, it had manifested itself, and now it was apparent again, manifest in a pathetic, dumb sorrow which was visible in many faces. Early the next morning, Wednesday, Martin Ladvenu and another friar were sent to Joan to prepare her for death, and Manchon and I went with them, a hard service for me. We tramped through the dim corridors, winding this way and that, and piercing ever deeper and deeper into that vast heart of stone, and at last we stood before Joan. But she did not know it. She sat with her hands in her lap and her head bowed, thinking, and her face was very sad. One might not know what she was thinking of her home, and the peaceful pastures, and the friends she was no more to see, of her wrongs, and her forsaken estate, and the cruelties which had been put upon her. Or was it of death, the death which she had longed for, and which was now so close? Or was it of the kind of death she must suffer? I hoped not, for she feared only one kind, and that one had for her unspeakable terrors. I believed she so feared that one that with her strong will she would shut the thought of it wholly out of her mind, and hope and believe that God would take pity on her and grant her an easier one. And so it might chance that the awful news which we were bringing might come as a surprise to her at last. We stood silent a while, but she was still unconscious of us, still deep in her sad musings and far away. Then Martin Ladvenu said softly, "Joan,